We'll be right back. All right, not many tech issues this time, so we've got Garma coming up with Crash Team Racing Nitro Fueled. Let's get it on with this.
It, I have to pick my setup first. So, 3, 2, 1, go. So, yeah, as you've seen in the schedule, this is Crash Team Racing Nitro Fueled. The game is a remake of the PS1 game called Crash Team Racing, which was released in 1999 for the PS1. The game features a lot more content than the original game. There's also content from Crash Nitro Kart, Crash Tag Team Racing, and a lot of other Crash games that have been released over the years. And the Nitro Fueled also has some new mechanics, or mechanics that were altered in some way. As you can see, there's a lot of loading. The loading times in this game are pretty horrible across all consoles. It's a bit worse on Switch than on other consoles because the Switch has not as strong hardware as the other consoles, but yeah, we will spend a lot of time looking at the loading screen. The basic tech in this game is power sliding. By power sliding, we can gain reserves. Reserves work as some kind of fuel that allows us to keep fire. Fire is the flame that comes out of the exhaust, and the basic rule is the bigger and brighter the flame is, the faster you go. So by power sliding like this and driving over a turbo pad, we have this bright yellow flame. This type of fire is called sacred fire within the community. The term is a bit edgy, and I bonked against the shield. Great. Yeah. Yeah, as you can see, a CPU just shot me with a missile. There's a bit of RNG in this run, because the CPUs can place items in very inconvenient spots over the track, and sometimes this blocks a shortcut or something else. And it shouldn't happen too often, but you never know.
Congratulations, you win a trophy. You can go faster through turns by power slide.
So
So Roost Tubes is the first track in the game that features downhills. Downhills are a bit interesting in this game because there is a certain trick you can do with TNT. I hope I can show it off. Yeah, but I have to set my luck on item rolls. Alright, a beaker is not what I wanted, but a TNT. So, in the next lap, I can use this TNT, hopefully, to get a lot of speed. Yeah, there it is. It's a very weird trick. I don't even know how this exactly works, but when you drive into a TNT while going downhill, you get very, very fast. And yeah, pretty weird mechanic. Whoa, that was close. Ah, 150, that was good. The funny thing is, there are three different types of podium animations, and the longest podium animation is about 4 seconds longer than the shortest possible podium animation. So over the course of the entire speedrun, you can pretty much lose an entire minute to podium animation RNG, which is pretty dumb, but yeah, that's just how it is. This shortcut that I just used is an off-road shortcut. By hopping repeatedly over it, the way hopping works is basically you don't decelerate while in the air. So when you have a certain amount of speed, you can just hop repeatedly and over off-road parts of the track, and you can do it pretty much without losing much or any speed at all. Thank you. Oops. Yeah, scratch the wall. CTR is pretty unforgiving. You basically lose all your reserves as soon as you hit a wall or get hit by an item. So, yeah, you pretty much have to drive flawless if you want to keep the maximum speed at all times. Yeah, 157, that was good.
Congratulations, you win a trophy. When you get a TNT crate on your head.
Coming at you full speed.
So coming up is Sewer Speedway. Sewer Speedway has a horrible shortcut in my opinion. It's very easy to not get it and bonk into a wall. I don't expect it to hit it three times, but yeah, we'll see what happens. And yeah, the Switch version has an issue where it sometimes freezes for 2 or 3 seconds at the start of a race. Yeah, as you probably noticed by now, most of the gameplay is actually to just power slide close to the wall and keep boosting to keep the flame coming out of your exhaust. That is pretty much most of the gameplay. Whoa. And I got crushed. This crate here is a Wumpa fruit crate. Basically, there is something that looks like an apple on top of the screen, and you can collect up to 10 Wumpa fruit, and each Wumpa fruit that you have makes your kart a little bit faster. If you have 10 Wumpa fruit, you are about 1 or 2% faster than with 0 Wumpa fruit. It is a minor difference, but it can make 3 or 4 seconds depending on the track. And also, if you have 10 Wumpa fruit, certain items have enhanced effects, like a TNT becomes a nitro crate or something. So this is our first boss race. This boss is Ripperoo. He is some kind of dog, I think, in a straitjacket. He usually talks in some weird gibberish. But since we skipped the cutscene, we don't see it, but yeah. Yeah, there he is, with a straight jacket. See you at the finish line. The bosses in this game have a unique feature. They have unlimited of a certain item, like Ripperoo plays his TNT is all over the track. And yeah, other bosses are similar to Ripper, but we'll see this over the course of the run. Yeah, we can use this, hopefully. Yeah, there are his TNTs. The TNTs are not random, they are pretty much always... I didn't get it. The TNTs that Ripperoo places over the track are pretty much always in the same spot, so there's no RNG involved. Yeah, and that was the first hub. The adventure mode of Nitro Fueled features only the 16 or 18, but in any percent it's only 16 tracks from the original CTR, so the adventure mode is basically the same as it was in the original game. And yeah, it ends with the race against Oxide. As you may have noticed, right at the start of this run, I was in the customization menu. Just like Mario Kart, Nitro Fueled has customization options. There are different kart bodies, different wheels, different paint jobs, but they are all purely just cosmetic, like they don't affect stats or anything. There is an extra option for selecting the character stats, and we are using the speed engine. Speed has the highest top speed and the lowest turning, which is both very good, since low turning allows us to power slide on straight lines, and high speed increases our top speed. So this track has an RNG shortcut, pretty much the only in the game. This one here. This shortcut can only be opened with a weapon that you can shoot, like a beaker or a bubble. Whoa. Okay. Cool. Yeah, Nitro, we don't want that. Alright, you got it 3 times, that's pretty lucky. In my PB I only got it 2 times, but yeah. still a bad time overall. But that's okay.
Congratulations, you win a trophy. The more Wampa fruit you collect, the faster.
Yeah, Aku Aku pops up to give the player tips about various aspects of the game. Like, he gives you the advice to jump when you drive into a TNT and things like that, but he stops doing that after 8 races, so yeah. He is just annoying if you know the game, and every time after you finish a race, Aku pops up and tells you things that you already know. It's pretty annoying, but yeah. He only does it for the first 8 races. So this track here is Coco Park. Coco Park is pretty much the easiest track in the game. It's just round and there's nothing special. There are no hazards or anything. And yeah. The reason why I'm scrolling through items is because in this game, first place can get a mask, and a mask makes you go a lot faster. It also makes you invincible, but invincibility is not the interesting part. But yeah, if you are lucky, you can get a mask, and that saves like a second or two if you get one. But the mask in first place is pretty rare. Usually it doesn't happen. But yeah. Yeah, 117. That's good.
Congratulations, you win a trophy. To get around a tight turn or to face.
So the next track is Papu's Pyramid. This is one of the hardest tracks actually, because there is a very tricky spiral right at the start, and it's very easy to hit the wall and to lose all your reserves. It's very hard to keep your flame going, and I don't expect to actually make it, but yeah, we'll see what happens. Usually I crash into the wall or scratch the edge just very slightly, and yeah, that's enough to lose your fire.
Watch out.
Got it. Yeah, if we lose the Sacred Fire here, then we can't make the jump up there, so we have to go down here. That's a bit slower, but not too much. Oops. Oh, what I forgot to mention is there is a mechanic in this game called U-turning. Basically, you can hop, brake, and turn around immediately. This allows even if you have a low turn stat, you can take pretty much any tight turn. So yeah, that's one of the reasons why the speed class is so good in this game, because they have a high top speed and low turning is pretty much irrelevant, since you can just U-turn everywhere. And so our next track is Dingo Canyon. Dingo Canyon has a shortcut which I will not be using. The reason is the shortcut is very, very narrow and it's extremely easy to hit the rock and cancel all your reserves immediately. Yeah. Yep. I can frog over here. You can get over this part of the track by going between the rocks on the very far right. But as I said, it's very easy to hit the rock and yeah. Armadillos on this track are very annoying. Yeah. Alright. Yeah, when they hit you, you begin to spin, and since that counts as being hit by a hazard, you lose all your reserves. And yeah. They're also pretty fast. It's hard to evade them.
Better luck next.
Yeah, 137 was pretty bad, but yeah, I fell down, and falling down is pretty costly. Lose a lot of time, at least 5 seconds on pretty much any track. Yeah. Sometimes more, sometimes less, but so this is the second boss, Papu Papu. Yeah, he pretty much plays his beakers all over the track, red beakers as well as green beakers. They are even more annoying than TNTs. But yeah. His home track is Papu's Pyramid, as the name suggests, so we have to do this wonderful track two times. And I lost 5. What? Yeah, he always places a red beaker right before the shortcut. That's very annoying, but yeah, it's not RNG, it's fixed. He does it always, so you can pretty much calculate it. That was hub 2. The adventure mode has 4 hubs. Every hub has 4 tracks, so that makes it 16 tracks. Yeah, over the course of the entire run. You can actually start to drive while the game is loading. But if you go to white, you crash into that wall. This boulder here is quite annoying. It's pretty easy to get hit by it. I hope it doesn't happen, but yeah, you never know. Good. Whoa, that bomb almost hit me. Yeah, that's pretty much RNG. Like sometimes when you begin to lap your opponents, Yeah, sometimes when you begin to lap the CPUs, you can pretty much get hit by an item you don't even see coming, like this bomb. Yeah, it's pretty annoying.
Congratulations, you win a trophy.
So, Dragon Mines is the next track. Dragon Mines is, for me, pretty much the hardest track in the entire adventure mode, and we have to drive it 2 times because it's the home track of the boss of this hub. The shortcut is very easy to fail, and failing the shortcut costs at least 10 seconds. It resets you all the way back to the track, and it costs a lot of time because you then have to take the normal route. And yeah, I hope I get the shortcut 3 times, but you never know.
See you at the finish line.
So there is the shortcut. You can hop over the rails here and jump on the track. And hope you don't get crushed by the minecart. And I hit an invisible wall. Yeah, keeping reserves on this track is very hard. Because you have few places where you can power slide, and it's just very easy to hit anything on this track. Whoa, barely made it. Oops. Whoa, the cart is coming. Yeah. Not fall down, yeah.
Better luck next.
Yeah, rail cards or whatever they are called are pretty annoying. They go pretty fast, and even if you have the orange flame you get by power sliding 3 times, they can easily catch up to you and basically squish you. And being squished is not what we want, because being squished makes us a lot slower and it also drains all our reserves. But yeah.
Congratulations, you win a trophy.
So, Polar Pass is the first track that features the fastest fire in the game. It's a bright blue flame. Yeah, every track in Hub 4 features blue fire, but Polar Pass is the first track in Hub 3 that features it, and it's the only one in Hub 3 that features it. And yeah, blue fire is a lot faster than sacred fire. So yeah, we want to keep blue fire for as long as possible. But since you're so fast with blue fire, it's actually very easy to hit a wall or an item or pretty much anything that is in your way. So there's a shortcut right here. You can just cut to the other side of the track. And there it is. Oh, I got a mask. Great. Yeah, that was RNG. So, I hope nothing else will be in my way at this lap. Since Blue Fire is so fast, we can just jump straight to the other side instead of jumping off of the boost pad. And yeah, that saves roughly two seconds or something. Also, since Blue Fire is so fast, we can just jump straight right here. And yeah.
Congratulations, you win a trophy.
Coming at you full speed.
So the last track in Hub 3 is Tiny Arena. Tiny Arena is the longest track in Adventure Mode, and it's the second longest track in the game overall. It's pretty basic actually, it's just a long track. It doesn't have any hazards or anything, it's just sliding, cornering, and U-turning, what is mostly used on the track, and these dark brown parts of the track are mud, and of course I want to avoid these spots because they slow me down.
you full speed.
Yeah, I had no luck with items on this track, no mask, but yeah, that's okay. Mask is pretty rare.
Better luck next time.
So coming next is the boss race. The boss in this track is Komodo Joe. He is some kind of dragon snake-like being. yeah. And his home track is Dragon Mines. Komodo Joe uses TNTs, much like Ripper, but he actually does something unique that even you as a player cannot do. He throws the TNTs out of the back of his card, and yeah, it's something that is impossible to do, and no other boss except Oxide does it. But yeah. Since we will never be behind Komodo Joe, the TNTs he throws aren't all that interesting, and yeah, we can easily avoid them. Uh-oh, yeah. Yeah, these rail cards are really annoying. It's so easy to get hit by them. Not only when entering the shortcut, but also after you've... Yeah, that was good. Oh no. Lucky. Oh, so the shield pretty much makes us invincible to items, and also to stage hazards, drag hazards. So if we have a shield and get hit by a minecart, we can just scrap it off.
You're not so slow.
So that was Hub 3. Now Hub 4, Hub 4 are where the difficult really picks up. Every track in Hub 4 is very long. They all feature blue fire, so it's very hard to control the card on these tracks because you're so fast. Yeah. And yeah, there's loading time when entering Citadel City. So the first track is Engine Labs. It's the home track of Engine. Engine is the guy that has a rocket sticking out of his head. Yeah. Engine Labs has a blue fire pad pretty much at the start of the first lap, so we pretty much will have blue fire for almost the entire course.
Better luck next time.
There is the blue fire bat. And there's this crazy tunnel. Hitting a wall on a track with blue fire is very bad, because losing blue fire costs extreme amount of time. Like, with blue fire you're 10 or sometimes even 20 seconds faster than without, and losing blue fire really can kill a PB. Oh, damn, I hit them all. Yeah. It's not too bad. There's blue fire pet coming up that you can use. Lost 4 seconds because I lost blue fire, but that's okay.
Congratulations, you win a trophy.
So the next track is Cortex Castle. Cortex Castle has a lot of turns. It's very hard to keep blue fire there because it's very easy to hit the corner of a wall or something. There's also very few space to actually power slide when you have blue fire because you're so fast. And yeah, it's very hard to keep blue fire on that track. It's among the hardest tracks in the game actually to keep blue fire on. I hope I can keep it, but yeah, you never know. It's very easy to hit that spot.
Woo!
What? What? Yeah, 158, that's actually okay. Could have been worse.
Congratulations, you win a trophy.
So, coming up is Hot Air Skyway. Hot Air Skyway bears a few similarities to Rainbow Road from the Mario Kart games. I mean, it's not a rainbow colored track, but it's a track high up in the sky, and you can fall down pretty much everywhere. And yeah, it's a very frustrating track for new players of this game, because it's so easy to fall down. Like you can see here, there are no boundaries. You can pretty much fall down everywhere on the track. Yeah.
Coming at you full speed.
Oops. Ah. Scratch the wall, but that's not too bad. What? Ah, great game. So, what just happened is, I think I hit the edge of the track or something. Yeah, that happens sometimes. It's very annoying when it happens, because you lose all your reserves and you also lose blue fire. But yeah. Hopefully I can make this jump. Yeah. At least that.
Whoops.
Yeah, I lost a few seconds because I lost blue fire, but yeah. That's the beauty of CTR. It's a high risk, high reward game. It's very easy to make a mistake and lose a lot of time, but yeah. You also get awarded a lot if you manage to master it.
Congratulations. You win a trophy.
So the next track is Oxide Station. Oxide is Oxide's home track, as the name suggests. Oxide is the final boss of the adventure mode. The story of this of the adventure mode is basically Oxide challenges the racers on Earth to a championship, and if he wins, then he will turn the Earth into a parking lot or something. It's a dumb story, and yeah, nobody really cares about it anyway. As you can see, Oxide Station is a very long track, it's a very narrow track, and yeah, here is the fire pad, and it's very easy to lose blue fire here. It's not as bad as Cortex Castle, since there is a lot of turbo pads here, which give you reserves, but it's very easy to scratch a wall and yeah, lose blue fire. Especially the spiral here at the beginning, it's very easy to lose blue fire here. Thankfully I made it. Yeah, these turns. It's so easy to hit anything on this track, really. We'll have to do this track twice because it's Oxide's track and we have to race against him on Oxide Station. And yeah. If this track had no blue fire, it would actually be the longest track in adventure mode. But since it has blue fire, you can clear it faster than Tiny Arena. Oh, Nitro. That was dangerous. And 2:39, that's only a second off my time trial PB. That's really good. It probably won't be as good against Oxide because he just puts way too many beakers on the track and it's almost impossible to avoid them. But yeah, we'll get to that later. So the fourth boss is Pinstripe. His home track is Hot Air Skyway. I don't particularly like Hot Air Skyway, but yeah, that's just how it is. He's a pretty annoying boss because he shoots bombs, and on lap 3 it's actually very easy to get hit by one of those bombs. I hope it won't happen but you never know. Ah, that was bad. I don't know how I avoided that beaker, but I did it. So yeah, now we'll see his bombs. I hope I don't... Yeah, okay, now it doesn't matter anyway. Great. Yeah, it's not too bad. The turbo pet is coming up right below there. And yeah. Now we don't have to care about the bombs anymore anyway. And yeah, since blue fire is so fast, we can... Whoa, okay, or we cannot. This track is very janky. It's so easy to hit the edge of the track and just lose all your reserves. It's very frustrating, but yeah, it happens sometimes. Right, so the last race is coming up. It's the race against Oxide on Oxide Station. And yeah, Oxide is pretty much the most annoying boss because he uses power-ups of pretty much every other boss. He uses TNTs, nitros, bombs, even throws beakers, but he doesn't just throw one beaker. Instead, he places two beakers on the track, which makes it even worse. And on level 3, it's very, very hard to avoid all those beakers. And I'm pretty sure I will run into one. I don't think I've ever had a run rate didn't happen. Oh, and Oxide is also a cheater. He starts way before us. As you may have noticed, I have 10 bumper fruit now. There are some tracks where I didn't collect bumper fruit. That's mainly because on some tracks the boxes are in pretty weird spots and you would lose a lot of time if you actually went for those boxes. So it's faster to just keep 0 bumper fruit and go the normal way. What? I didn't even hit anything, okay? Yeah, that's not too bad. The pet is coming up. A minor time loss. Yeah. So now we will start to see his items. Luckily at this Now we will start to see the beakers, and it's very hard to avoid them. Because yeah, as you can see, he places them in very inconvenient spots, and especially with blue fire, you really don't have enough leeway to really avoid them all. We can get sometimes it works. Yeah, wait, time. Totally did think about that. Yeah, that was pretty much the adventure mode of CTR. Pretty much just racing, because it's a racing game. And yeah. I hope you had fun. It's a great game. A lot of fun to play. Yeah. I don't know what else to say.